Howdy mappers, and welcome to the second part of my tutorial about ruins in Perspectives 3. As before, this tutorial is also available in a blog format for those who prefer to read and perhaps can supplement the video a bit if you want to look up things. You'll find that link to that article in the video description below. Also, if you have any questions, if you need help or anything with this tutorial, I highly recommend that you come visit us at the ProFantasy community forums. The links are also below in the video description. Often I see comments there much earlier than I see on the YouTube comments, and it's a much easier place to hold a discussion and help people, so I highly recommend you drop by there instead of asking questions, technical questions and such, here in the video comments. Of course, if you have general comments to the video and things, you are welcome to post in the comment section below as well. So, today we will be talking about battlements. And just zoom into my example map here. This is my Arena Keep map, which I also showed in the previous video. And you can see that up here I have a little battlement section with a parapet wall with crenellations, and we can see that we have some ruined wall sections as well. So what I'm going to teach you today is basically how to create these battlements, how to create this parapet wall, and how to create these ruined sections of the wall. So I'm just gonna start, and I'm gonna continue with the map I used for the first part of my tutorial. You might remember I showed you how to create a ruined wall. This is the wall we have down here. We created this ruined segment. Last time we used something called a color key effect to make basically a hole in this wall to accomplish this. Today we'll be looking at other techniques. We'll be looking at how we can actually build perspective objects ourselves from scratch and make them look like real perspective objects and behave in the same way. So just zoom in here, and the first thing we're going to need is some kind of wall. I mean, a battlement is a top of a wall, so we kind of need a wall to put it on top of. So I'm gonna start by visiting my perspective settings and check that I have the settings I want. Okay, I want my castle wall to be made from stones, not flat like this. I'm gonna use this fill later, but right now I am going for this setting, which gives me a nice castle wall. Okay, so that's a good setting, and I'm gonna create a wall as a base. As before, I want to create a 2 foot wide wall, 25 foot high. So I'm just gonna right click the wall, do a wall choose thickness. It's already suggests 2 feet. Just type it again, not necessary to repeat it really. I could just have hit enter and it would have used default. And I'm gonna start by making a wall. Little bit of wall here, and we want a little corner on our wall, and just another bit of corner. Okay, that's the wall. Right click to tell we are done, and I want this wall to be 25 foot high. Okay, we're gonna have to remember that number for later, because that will be important in the perspective things when we get that far. But right now I have this wall. Okay, the wall isn't really our main approach or main focus on this video. It's the battlement we're going to talk about, and the battlements will be drawn atop of the wall. But drawing something on top of this wall do have some issues. It's a bit complicated, and we can see a bit why when we look at our grid. If you look at the bottom here, you can see that the grid lines go neatly across the wall here, or at the same place as the wall, the bottom. But at the top, you can see the top of the wall does not align with these grid lines at all. I mean, the direction is the same, but it's not on the grid the same way as the bottom. And that means that it's going to get a little bit more complicated if I start working up here. So instead, my preferred approach is to actually work at ground level and draw the entire battlement at ground level, and then just lifting it up in the end when I'm done. This is much easier. So what I'm going to do then is first of all to create a floor that will be the floor of my battlement, and I want it to extend a little bit out past the wall. So let's do that, and I'm just going to use the floor tool to do that. So to go out past the wall, you can start here, and you can notice I have snap on, and you can see that it also snaps to the midpoints. That's default behavior with snap usually. Check the snap settings. Use an isometric 5-foot grid actually with 2 snap divisions. Now that means that I actually have quite a few snap points, because these grid squares are actually 10 feet. You can measure that just to show you that. If I go to info and distance and I measure from here to here, it's 10 feet. So I actually have 3 snap points in each. Look where the cursor snaps, here and here and here. And I have additional snap points inside as well. I'm not going to use these snap points inside here. I'm more interested in snap points along the lines. Now, to draw the floor, I need something called a polygonal floor. That's because, as you can see, this isn't just a straight rectangle. So I'm just going to right click the floor button and choose a polygonal floor. Okay, can now go here. First node, half a grid square out from the wall. I keep it half a grid from the wall. Place down the next node. Place down the next node. And place down the next node. So now it will extend half a grid square from the wall. And I'm just gonna give myself some room behind here. Behind the wall isn't really that important. I just need some space to work. Okay, there we go. I have the floor. Now, of course, as I said earlier, this floor is going to be lifted up on top of the wall when I'm done working. But right now, I prefer to work right down here at the ground level. And since I'm working at the ground level, this wall is actually in my way right now. I don't need to see it now. I will need it later, so I can delete it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make myself a new layer. And I already made one here. I call it work in progress hide. It's just a layer I can put things on that I want to hide temporarily. So I'm gonna make sure this is set to hidden. Oh, sorry, that's frozen. Ah, that's hidden. Make sure it's not the active layer. If it's the active layer, you cannot hide or freeze it. So then these buttons wouldn't work. But now it's hidden. And I'm gonna use change properties on my wall. Do it. And I'm gonna put it on the work in progress hide layer. Okay, gonna redraw, and the wall is gone. We can bring it back later when we need it. Okay, now what I'm going to do is I'm gonna draw the parapet wall on top of the battlement. But I need to do that in 2 steps. As you know, castle walls usually have crenellations. The crenellations are actually the holes between the wall segments. So I'm not actually drawing crenellations themselves. I'm drawing the wall segments between crenellations to be precise. But I need to do it in two steps. I need to draw the lower half of the wall, which is a whole wall, no holes in it or anything. And then I need to put these segments on top that separates between the crenellations. And it's these segments on top that I want to give a more ruined look. So we're gonna look into that. But first of all, I do not want the parapet wall to have the same stone type as the castle itself. This has a little bit with how things are constructed, and when it's extended from the castle like this, it looks a bit weird with these large stones balancing. So I'm gonna go for a more solid surface. So I'm gonna put perspective settings, and I'm just gonna pick the stone B wall. This is the wall we actually had in the settings box at the beginning. Okay. And I'm gonna draw a wall along the edge here on top of where my wall will be. So again, just right click wall, choose thickness. I want it 2 foot thick, so accept that. The first end will be at this node. So, but note something, when I drag the wall here, can you see that its center point of the wall are running along the edge? But I don't really want the center point of the wall to be along the edge here. I want the outer edge of the wall to align with the edge of the floor. And if you look at my command prompt right now, it says next node or enter distance, and in parentheses it says shift move handle. And that's what I want to do. I want to move the handle. The handle tells me where I am handling the wall. And I am actually working on these points on the edge of the floor. So as long as the handle is on the outer edge of the wall, then the wall will align correctly. So I'm going to press the shift button on my keyboard. Just hold on the shift button. And I'm going to drag the mouse away from the wall. Can you see that line going from the crosshairs on the mouse to the edge of the wall? That shows where the handle is placed. If I drag the mouse the other way, you can see that the handle is now placed on the other side of the wall. Just look at where it meets the wall. See. It's a bit more difficult to hit the center, but here it's in the center. And here it is on the outer edge. So I don't click or anything, I just release shift, and you can see now that the wall aligns with the edge of the floor instead of aligning along the center of the wall align on the floor. So now I can just place the node in the corner, place the node in the corner, and I place the node in the corner. And notice how it correctly handled the wall all the way through. It's on the inside, even though I went through several corners. Click to place, right click to end. And I want the entire parapet wall to be 6 feet tall. That's enough for a man-sized being to hide behind. So that means that the lower half should be 3 foot. So again, I type 3 on the command line. Enter, and I get 3 foot tall wall. So that's the first part of our parapet wall. Now the next is the partial wall on top, the wall segments between the crenellations. And to make that, I'm gonna use a command here, the 3D box. And 3D box is very similar to a wall, actually. So I'm just gonna click it. I'm gonna place the first corner here in where the grid intersects, because that makes it easy to handle later. So I'm gonna place the first corner right here. Okay, I want it to be 5 feet long. Now, there are many castle designs out there, many different looks to castles. Some have large wall segments with large crenellations, some are large wall segments with tiny crenellations, they may have angled walls in the crenellations. to make those behind them even more difficult to hit, things like that. I'm going for the simple approach right now. So I'm going for just 5 foot wall segment, followed by 5 foot crenellation, 5 foot wall segment, and so on. And as I said and showed earlier, these squares are 10 foot long. So if I go to the snap point in the middle, that should give me exactly 5 feet. So just click. Now it wants the width. This is more difficult to drag with the mouse to get them exactly. I want a width to be the same as my wall here. And I know that's 2 foot. So again, look at the command prompt. It says third corner or enter length. And in square bracket square, that means that if I just hit enter now without supplying any data, it will assume I want a square wall. I don't want that. So I'm just going to type in the number 2 for a length of 2. Okay, and how tall do we want it? Well, I said 6 foot in total. The bottom is 3 feet, so the top should also be 3 feet. It already suggests 3 feet, so you can just hit enter, or I can just type 3 in. Okay, that's all there is to it. I now have a little box here, which behaves very much like my existing walls. So, what I really need to do now is to place this on top of this wall segment. Now, I could just click copy, pick it up, and yeah, the outline can be a bit difficult to see here. So, place it, and that didn't work out so very well. And even if the outline had been a bit easier to see right now, it wouldn't really have worked out very well to just place it by eye like that. So I always like to do this by precision placement. And how do I do that? Well, we have our trusty modifiers, which are going to help us. So look here. You see this corner of the wall right here should match up with this corner up here. I hope everyone agrees with that. So how can I do that? Well, I use the copy command. I select the entity. I hit do it. And the first thing it asks is the point to copy from. Well, I want to select this corner exactly. Well, that's easy. If I just turn snaps back on, the snap will help me click exactly in that corner. And we had snap on when I placed this thing in the earlier, so I know it's exactly in the corner. So snap is good. Always remember to keep snap on unless you really want to turn it off. We need to do that sometimes. So I'm just gonna click here. This is my copy point. When I do that, that means that the copy of the entity will use this point as an origin point. So even if I don't see the outline very well, I know that the origin point is exactly at my crosshairs. So if I place it here, it turns out exactly at the border like I want. Okay, I didn't want it there, but for the next step, I'm going to place it on top of the wall. Well, how do I do that? This is the same problem as I talked about with the larger wall earlier. The bottom of the wall is nicely aligned with the grid lines and matches snap points and everything. But if you see how my cursor behaves, there is no snap point exactly at the top of that wall. And that's not to be expected either. If we had snap points every possible location for every possible wall height we could ever imagine, it would mean that the entire map would be covered in snap points anyway, and they would be useless to us. So in this case, I'm going to use the modifiers. In this case, the endpoint modifier. The endpoint modifiers works that when you click the modifier and you click something else in the map, you can see there is a line right here, the edge of the wall. If I click here near the top of the line, but not exactly at the top of the line, it got positioned perfectly. And why was that? Well, because the endpoint modifier saw that, okay, I wanted to use the endpoint, and I clicked on that line, so it wanted the endpoint of this line. Well, the endpoint of this line is up here in the corner. And since this was picked up by this corner, it means that this little corner was matched up with the top corner here, which I got via the endpoint modifier. So using modifiers for precise placement is key to get this correctly. Do not just look at it and try to place it by eye. You will mess it up and there will be issues. Now, I want to fill out the rest of this. And what's the easiest way to do that? Well, again, I'm going to use the copy command. So, copy, and I'm going to copy this, and I'm going to hit do it. But right now, I am going to copy it relatively to where it is right now. So, you remember when I copied up here, it was very, very important to actually select the copy point correctly, the origin points of the copy. Well, for what I'm doing now, it doesn't really matter. I can place it up here if I want to, and yeah, I can just click here. Because it doesn't really matter at all. What I want to do is that I want to place it relatively to where I placed it before. And last video, I introduced you to polar coordinates. And I'm gonna have to use these again. Because what I want to do is to take this entity, which I already have selected and I'm ready to place, and copy it in this direction. And I'm gonna copy it 10 feet in this direction. Why 10 feet? I said I wanted 5 foot distance, didn't I? Well, that's because when I start at this edge here, first 5 foot is to the other end of the entity itself. Then I want 5 foot hole before the entity starts. So the copy distance should be 10 feet. The next thing I need to know is the direction. And I know that in a perspective map, the direction along this grid line downwards this way is always 330 degrees. That's fixed in perspectives. And as long as I draw something that follows the grid lines, like I've done here, the walls are parallel to the grid lines, the direction will be 330 feet. Also, not 330 feet, 330 degrees. Of course, if I didn't know that before, I could use the bearing command from the info menu to figure out the exact bearing, but I know it's 330. Also, when we are going the other way, along the other set here, up down here, it's 30 degrees. So 330 and 30 are two numbers which are worthwhile to remember. Okay, so how am I going to get this 10 feet and 330 degrees this direction? Well, as I showed in the last video, when we want to use polar coordinates, we start by typing this less than sign. And remember, when CC3+ asks us to place something like this, place, as it says, we can always place things by clicking with the mouse somewhere, or I can do it by typing in the coordinates. So in this example, I'm going to type in the coordinates. The first thing I need is the degrees, 330, comma, the distance I want to copy it, 10, right? I'm going to move it 330 degrees, that's this way, and I'm going to move it 10 feet in that direction. Enter. There it is. And when you do copy with CC3+, it doesn't end the command immediately. It allows you to place further copies. You can see here it still says place. So I can just type this exact same thing again. And notice that these coordinates are relative from the previous placement. So I can type the same thing again. And again. And one last time. There we go. That's all we need to get those into 330 degrees along this wall. I can now hit escape to stop copying. Okay, that was the first wall. The second wall is at an angle. And also an angle to the first one, 90 degree angle to be exact. And in perspective 3, as I have mentioned before, everything is really an illusion. So I cannot just rotate these objects. If this was a true 3D modeling software, I could just take this box and rotate it and place it along this wall. But we cannot do that here. So I need to make another one. So that's quick. Click. Click. What wanted it? No, so 2 foot wide, 3 foot tall. There we go, we have the box. Okay, now the trick is I want to start with a 10-foot gap here. How do I do that? Well, I don't really have a good point use modifiers on to do that, but I can just take this one, copy it, copy from point again. Now the copy from point is very important, should be down in the corner. And I'm going to use the endpoint modifier first on this line. You can see from this previously placed segment. This isn't 10 foot away, but... Oh, sorry, 5 foot away. I meant 5 foot. It's not 5 foot away, but it gives me a marker. I can use this as a marker. It's now 5 foot. So let me place the next one next to this, using this as place. And I'm gonna erase this one. And there we go. Perfectly placed. You might have noticed when I was copying that things were overlapping in strange orders. And that's something we need to deal with in Perspectives 3. If I wanted to keep the one in the middle here, I would have needed to use some of these ordering tools to arrange these entities, which should be on the top and which should be on the bottom and so on. But since it was only a temporary copy, I just deleted it and didn't really need to mess with that part. Now I can just take this one and again do as before. The copy from point doesn't matter because it's going to be relative to the current position. So just click somewhere. And this time I know it's 30 degrees to go this way and not 330 as we used earlier. So again, 310 and one more 330. No, sorry, 30.10. There we go. Now we are starting to get somewhere. So the final part of the puzzle is final wall segment here. Okay, this is going to be again slightly more tricky because I want this 5 foot gap. It's not that tricky again. I'm just gonna copy one of these. Fine, do it. And I instantly regretted that decision because I need to get a precise point to copy from, so I should have copied the other one. But doesn't really matter. I can just use the endpoint modifier and make sure I pick it from the bottom like this. This should be right. I can place a test copy here. Yep, that's right. So, again, where do I place it? Well, I have an outline here. I can use this line as a guideline. We can see that this line ends up here in the corner. So again, midpoint, and there we go. Again, this is just a temporary spacer. So I'm going to use the endpoint on this line. Make sure when you use the endpoint modifier to click near the right end of the line. I mean, any line have two ends, like this line here has a bottom and a top end. And the endpoint modifier will pick the end that is closest to the end you clicked in. So if you want to actually place something near the top corner here, it's important when you use the endpoint modifier that you click close, not at the corner, but close to the corner. If I click down here, it's gonna pick the bottom here instead. So I'm gonna just delete this one, and again I'm gonna repeat the copy command. But right now I'm gonna show you one neat little trick. You saw that when I copied this one down here, I had to type the same number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 times, and there was always a possibility of typing it wrong each time. And I can make this a little bit easier on myself by assigning the coordinates to a variable before starting copying. So I'm going to show you a quick little trick. If you don't understand this trick and it doesn't make sense, just copy it like I did a few minutes earlier. But I'm going to type on the command line GL. GL gets a text string from input into a variable. You can see now it asks for a variable, and I'm going to type this variable name each time I want to copy it. So I'm going to make it short and sweet, nothing difficult to type. So I'm just going to call the variable A. And inside the variable A, I'm going to put this text, less than 330, 10. You remember this. This is the coordinates, the relative coordinates I used for copying the object before. It's just that I'm putting it into a variable instead of using it directly in the copy command. Now, I'm going to go to the copy command. I'm gonna select this. I'm gonna do it. Again, the point to copy from doesn't matter now. So I'm just gonna click anywhere. And now we have this place command line. Okay, earlier I typed 30.10. But now I just assigned those numbers to the variable A. So I can just actually just type A. Voila. A. Voila. A. See? Much simpler. I didn't have to type the coordinate each time. Saved me from potentially typing them wrong, doing getting a number wrong or something like that. So using variables like that can be quite neat, but it's not required. As you saw, I already copied the first part here without using any kind of variables. Okay, so let me clean up a few of those extra here. So there we go. We have the basic battlement. I'm not going to be too concerned that it just ends on this end. I'm assuming this is part of some larger building or something, so I'm not even going to try to do anything special with the end. I'm just gonna leave it exactly as it is. This is just a partial wall and not a complete building. But I promised you one thing. I promised you how to make a ruined wall. And right now it looks just whole and fine. No broken parts, no anything. So we need to figure out how can I mess this up, making it look old, broken, falling apart. Well, let's go back to this object. You might remember I drew this object using the 3D box command. And Campaign Cartographer can draw several different shapes. But sometimes we do need shapes that are not available by default. I mean, there in a way Campaign Cartographer could have any conceivable possible shape for all kind of ruins and everything out of the box. So let's learn how we can actually draw these ourselves. And we're gonna do that by basing it upon this box. First thing we're going to do is we're gonna basically build a wireframe version of this 3D box. So I'm gonna make myself a new layer. I think I already have it, but the layer called construction. I'm gonna make that the active layer. I like to use a construction layer when I'm painting temporary lines. so that I can easily hide them when I don't need to see them and easily bring them back. Okay, so yeah, I also already have a sheet called Battlement. I'm gonna work on a wall sheet for now. You can see that these things here are all on the walls sheet. When I draw things using the different commands, most of them ends up on the wall sheet by default. So we're gonna work on the wall sheet for now. We're actually going to move things to that battlement sheet later, but because campaign cartographer puts things on the wall sheet by default, it's easier to just work on that sheet for now and move things later rather than trying to put every individual object on the correct sheet as we go. Okay, I need a color. Usually I use this color, but right now I'm not going to do that, because if you followed last time, you remember we still have the drawing from last time in here, and right here you can see the shape with the color key shape we drew to be able to cut a hole in our wall. Well, what color do you think that is? Well, yeah, that's that color. So if I draw anything in this color, it will turn invisible because the color key will hide it. So I'm just gonna pick a slightly different color to not conflict with the existing color key. Okay, and for these lines, I'm gonna use the basic line tool in Campaign Cartographer. I'm not going to use parts, because later I'm going to need to isolate individual lines and things like that. So let's start with a line. Where's the first line? Well, that should be this line right here, okay? So let's draw a next here. I can use the snap point to place this line. That's fine. First line. The second line, okay? To show it snap, but at this line, Well, how can I draw this line? There is no snap point here that will help me. I could get up here and get the correct direction, but then I didn't get the correct length. Well, the answer is obviously polar coordinates. I already showed you when I copied these on the wall around the corner, which you can see right now, that we have a 30 degree angle here. So I'm going to do 30. And we know that the wall is 2 feet wide, so 30.2. There we see, I have drawn a new nice little line. Okay, I need to go back here, I need to complete the box shape. And that line should be 330, but 330 is the other way, so 330.2. Minus 5 should be the opposite direction, and the final one, snap, will help me just click. Okay, so this is the bottom square of a wireframe version of this one, a bottom rectangle. These two lines here can't really be seen in this figure here, but I want them right now to be able to actually see what's happening and how things is working out. It makes them much easier to understand the figure. So now I need the lines sticking up. Well, we know that these lines are straight up 90 degrees, and we know that they are 3 foot long because that's the height of the wall. Okay, so I can go here and I can type 90.3. That's one line. And to be able to place it in the corner right there, you can see it in my snap. Don't help me, and use again the endpoint modifier here, 90.3, and I do the same again. You see the modifiers are extremely helpful here, 90.3, and first that one, then that, okay, there we go. Error message you saw was just because I was actually clicking the modifier before I started the command, and that doesn't really make sense to campaign cartographer. So again here, 90.3, there we go, and we need a top. Well, the top is just a copy of these four lines on the bottom, so I'm just gonna copy them. And again, this is a relative copy, click anywhere, and where do I want to place it? Well, obviously 90 degrees, 3 feet up. There we go. What I've built here is now a wireframe version of this box. You can also see the back lines and everything. And when I'm gonna make this appear ruined now, it's important to base it upon this wireframe because I need to make sure that I'm not making segments appearing outside this box for some reason. That would make sense. I mean, parts of it are missing, but there shouldn't be parts added to it or anything like that. So, I already drew this on my construction layer. So let me go to the construction. I don't want to work on that anymore. I'm gonna just work on the walls layer. And then I can freeze the construction layer. By freezing the construction layer, I ensure that I won't mess with these lines accidentally. So now we are ready to start working. Okay, so how do I want this to be broken? Well, I think I basically want something like the top right corner of this missing. So that's what we're going to work against. Okay, so with that in mind, the first thing I'm going to draw are the whole lines. Lines that are not affected by the broken entity. So I'm gonna make this black. And again, I'm just default to the line tool. So and now it's not broken along the bottom. So we can use endpoint. And if you see here, this is something that can happen if I try to use the endpoint along a grid line. Campaign cartographer, when I click endpoint and I clicked here, we'll see which lines are at this point, and it will pick one of them and find the endpoint. So it picked actually the grid line and found the endpoint. It's not what I want to do. So just escape. I could, several ways I could approach this to actually easily get that point. One of them is to make sure I use another line. For example, if I use this line, this doesn't overlap a grid, but it also ends exactly in the corner as I want to, so I can use this one. And for the second corner, I use this line. For the third corner, doesn't really matter. And I missed. There we go. And here. And we need to go back up, so there we go. Now I draw on the bottom. I'm gonna repeat this and draw lines up. See, sometimes if I'm not precise when I click with the modifier, it doesn't place a point at all. It just means that I clicked outside the line, so there wasn't any place to put it. If that happens, it's just basically try again. It's just you, or in this case me, who didn't click properly. Okay, now I have drawn black lines on top of the purple ones wherever things are not broken. But I said I wanted the top corner here to be broken off. So there are still parts of these lines here and here and here and here that should be whole lines. So I'm gonna draw these as well, again with the line command, the end point to get the position here. The important point now is that I want this point to be along this line. It should not be the end point, but it should be exactly on this line. I don't want to just click here and hope for the best. And for these cases, we have another modifier, the on modifier. This modifier ensures that whatever point you pick is on another entity. It can be anywhere. It doesn't get an end point or anything. It just ensures that the point you click on the entity. Just see here, if I click this and I click somewhere not on an entity, no line is placed at all. So I can just retry. If I click right here, it places the point perfectly on the entity. I could, if I wanted them to be exactly midway, I also have this midpoint modifier which I could use. But I don't really want this right now. So again, endpoint to get the first point at the corner, and on to get the point in the middle right here. And we are going to do the same thing with these lines. There's a lot of clicking and a lot of work to get all of this correctly. So, and you can see I use the modifiers a lot. I try to always click on the buttons to show you people what modifiers I'm using at any given time. But normally when I work with a map by myself, I use the function key on my keyboards instead. It's a much faster way to access the modifiers, instead of going to the buttons all the time. You can find the functions keys here under Tools and Snaps. And now you can see, for example, the endpoint modifier is F5, midpoint is F3, point on is F9, and so easier. So that's a much easier way to actually access those modifiers than using the buttons all the time. Okay, I have now drawn black lines over the purple lines where I want the unbroken sections to be. Let me hide the construction layer so we can see this a bit clearer now. As we can see, we have a box in the making. For the final part, I want some broken segments. And to do that, I'm gonna need the fractal part, this command here. So let's just get to it, click the fractal part, and it wants a starting point, so I want to start up here, so guess what, that's the endpoint modifier. Again, it's always important to get all of these placements precise, so always use the endpoints or other modifiers, or snaps if you're going to hit exactly on a snap point like this. Do not just place them by eye. Okay, we did talk about the fractal part in the previous video, but the important part here is that we can see that the fractalization is not high enough to look anything good right now. So we can see that it says something depth, left and right arrows. The depth is how many additional nodes will be added to the part, and the more nodes, the more detailed it will be. So I'm gonna click 5 times on the right arrow. Camping cartographer needs a little bit of time to process each click, so don't just click 5, click, but give it like click, 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 click. That's 5 times. And let me move the mouse a little bit. And maybe I was just a bit too fast because it didn't get all. 1, 2, 3, and 4. I took the first one. Okay. That's 5 clicks. So as you can see on the part if it didn't really add anything. Now we have a detailed part. Don't go too detailed on this one. It's going to add a lot of nodes, which will slow down campaign cartographer if it gets too many. And remember, you don't usually intend to watch this as closely zoomed in as I have it right now. So the point there is just look that the line looks somewhat reasonable. I don't like that sharp fall at the top, which is going slightly backwards. So I'm just going to hit space to re-randomize until I find something I like. I think this one looked good. So again, pick the endpoint and place the endpoint like that. Now, I am going to need to access these lines individually. You can see I can continue with my fractal part, so I could basically click, 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 and getting done. But I want these as individual lines. So I'm going to right click to finish the command right now, and I'm going to start a new one. It's a bit more clicks to do that, because that means I need to set the starting point, and I need to set the fractalization settings again, but again, I need the individual lines. If I drew it as one continuous part, I would need to use a command such as break to break it up later. So I'm gonna draw individual parts. That's fine. And two more. Two. Five, and for the final one, again, press spacebar until I'm happy with how the part looks. Be a bit aware, you don't need these corners to be too tiny, narrow, or sharp. That won't look good. But I think this one is going to look fine. So, that's a wireframe version of our ruin box. But now we need to basically add fills. We need to add individual sides, like this one is made of three sides. We're gonna end up with four sides: the front, the side, the top, and the ruined section right here. All of these will be visible. So what I'm going to do is that I'm going to copy the lines for each surface over here and make a surface from each set of lines. And it's important that I actually copy these lines, because as you can see, this line right here, it's shared between two surfaces, the front and the top. If I make a surface from the line right here, that will mean that the top will suddenly be missing this line, because it was already being used up when I converted it to this front surface. So I need to actually copy the lines to do that. Before we start copying, there are two things I want to make sure. The first one is that our fill style is correct. And I want to use the same fill as this is using. So let me check perspective settings. Okay, and I'm gonna click the advanced dialog. And I can see that my wall, this is the side of the wall, is using a fill style called Stone Brown Flat P3A. Actually, at the top and the end is using the same fill. So this is the fill style I want to make sure I'm using. Fine. So as you can see, this fill style is already selected in my map. But if it isn't when you're working, make sure click on the indicator, go to bitmap files, and just pick the correct fill style from the dropdown. Okay. Also make sure that line width is set to 0. And now we can start working. Okay, I'm gonna do the copy command. Now I want snap on again because I want precise placements. And I'm gonna start by picking the five lines that outlines the front section like this. Do it. I'm gonna put the origin for the copy right there in the grid intersection. I'm gonna place the result in this grid intersection. Now, I'm gonna right click on explode and choose the command line to part. Line to part converts basic lines into parts, and if the parts are connected all the way, like mine is here, it will automatically be connected into into a polygon. So I'm gonna do line to part, and I'm gonna do that and do it. See? And it used the properties that was set there. That's why the fill style and line width was important to set before we did anything. Let's do the top next. Again, I'm gonna copy four lines that make up the top. Gonna do it and from this grid intersection to this grid intersection. And we have copied the lines. Now, again, I'm gonna change them into a surface. But instead of selecting them, I'm gonna show you a little bit of other trick. I do, again, line to part. I don't select the lines. I right click and I select prior instead. See that? The lines got selected. When I copy something with the copy command, it means that I can always access the copy later by doing a selection by prior, like I did now. It will automatically select the last thing I copied. That is, unless I've done another command in the meantime, then the prior might be overwritten by something else, another entity. You can also access the prior from the keyboard by just hitting the P key on the keyboard when you're asked to make a selection. So again, do it. So this is a quick way to actually get the lines you wanted. For example, the line that was here was a bit tricky to select, because if I tried to click on that line, it would also have selected this surface which I made earlier. Of course, in this case, it wouldn't been a big problem, because I could just hold on the control key and click on this to deselect it. But in other cases, selecting by prior can be very helpful. So I'm gonna do that again for my next copy. I'm gonna do copy. I'm gonna select four lines belonging to the side. Again, do it. I'm gonna click here. I'm gonna click here. Right click to end the copy command. I'm gonna do line to part. I'm gonna hit P on my keyboard like that, and then I'm gonna hit D on my keyboard to do it, and I'm done. And same thing for the last four lines. Again, def do it, click, right click, line to part, P for prior, D for do it. Simple as that. Okay, we can now see that we have the ruined shape somewhat here, but it's a bit difficult to see because it kind of blends into each other, while we can see on the wall up here that, well, it's got different colors and it actually has some black lines to make it more visible. And that's what we're going to do right now. The different color come from shading. It basically takes the angle in regards to the light source of the map and colors things accordingly. So when we do that, we're basically just going to tell how this is oriented towards the light source. And the best way to do that with this entity is to actually grab the data from our existing entity here, which works as it should out of the box. So I need to find some information about this entity, and this is not just one entity, actually it's a lot of entities, but it has three main parts: the top, the left side, and the right side. And if I go to info list and select it, you can see everything is selected. Select one of them, and there's a lot of information down here, and I don't really know exactly which one I want to access. But the important thing here is this object is actually a list of entities which are grouped together. I can see here this is a group. So if I just click here on this button that said locked, it switches to unlocked, and that refers to groups. Groups are now unlocked. Look what happens if I do list and I click here. See that? Only this surface gets selected because It doesn't select the entire group, it only selects this surface. Exactly what I need to do. So again, do it. And I'm interested in two pieces of data. And this is how this shading entity, it's the angle and the pitch. Okay, you can see that this seems to be a little bit weird number. That's just a precision error. It's a little bit based on how computers work with double precision numbers. I'm not going to go into detail here, but to put it shortly, the angle is 30 degrees. We don't really need to be that exact because that's not correct anyway. So it's 30 degrees and the pitch is 70 degrees. That's what we are interested in knowing. 30 degree angle, 70 degree pitch. Okay? And that was this surface, so that means that I'm gonna change this surface here. I'm gonna right click the polygon, and I'm gonna do something called a shaded polygon. I'm gonna select this one, and do it. Notice the command line right now. It asks for the angle. Okay, so the angle was 30 degrees. Now it wants to know the pitch. Well, that was 70 degrees. Done. See? Instantly switch. Now this is the same shade as this. Let's repeat it with this entity. And you can see here that the angle is 330 degrees. The pitch is still 70 degrees. And the 30 and 330 might be something you recognize. You might remember 330. Well, that was the bearing down this line. We worked with that earlier. And 30 was this direction. So that's where those numbers come from. Again, I'm going to do a shaded polygon right there. Do it. Angle is not 30 for this one, but it's 330. The pitch is still 70. Done. Now, our object looks a little bit more like the real thing. The final piece of the puzzle is the black outlines, as we see here. Okay, and we already have the black outlines ready to go here. The only thing is that this contains a few lines that cannot be seen because they're hidden behind. Like this line shouldn't be here, this line shouldn't be here, this line shouldn't be here. So let's just simply erase them. There we go, we now have an outline. Again, let me just copy this outline to it from this point to this point. And there we go. Now we have a kind of ruined wall board. Okay, and now we can just replace one of the existing wall boards with this one. So again, I'm gonna do a copy. I forgot one thing. Did you remember what I told you about this one? It was grouped. Unlock group. I can lock groups again, but I actually want to group my entity as well. So I go to tools, groups, group, select this entity and do it. It's now a group. Now I'm gonna copy it, do it again. I want to do a precision copy, so I want to copy from this corner down here. And where do I want to place it? Well, I want to replace some of the existing ones here, so I can actually use the endpoint modifier here, and endpoint modifier here, and let's put one here as well. Just copy it again. There we go. And of course, I'm just going to delete the old one. same up here, just gonna delete those ones and gonna redraw. There we go. We now have a couple of ruined wall sections on top of our battlement. Of course, just having one design might get a little repetitive, so you should probably draw more than one. You also need maybe one for this direction, and as I mentioned earlier, when we created the second segment right here, in a perspective map, since this isn't a true 3D program, I cannot just simply rotate it and hope that I get the result I want. For those of you curious what will happen if I try to rotate something like that, let's just do it. We have my entity here, and I'm just gonna rotate it by a random angle, and as you can see, that's not what you really expected to happen when I rotated it, did you? Now it's suddenly lying on its side, and it's not what it originally was. And that's one of the, if I could call it an issue, it isn't really an issue because it isn't a fault with the program itself. It's just that Perspectives tries to emulate 3D by using angles in a clever manner. That's actually called an isometric view, and it's a common graphical technique. But since these aren't true 3D objects, it also means that they cannot be rotated in an easy manner. So if you want them for other direction, you should just redraw them using the same principles as we already did. And that also helps a little bit in making things different, because if you can just rotate them, then they will still be identical, just in a different position. So it helps a little bit there as well. Well, okay, it seems like we are getting things done, but as you might remember, this battlement was meant to be on top of a wall. And well, we did hide that wall earlier. Let's just show it. There we get the wall. Well, we want all of this to be on top of that wall. We don't want it to be on the bottom like here. So I'm gonna hide this again. And if you remember from the beginning, that wall was 25 feet tall. So all I have to do is to move all of this 25 foot straight up. Straight up as in a 90 degree angle. Straight up on the screen is 90 degrees. So just use the move command. Gonna select everything. I don't really need these silly things here, so I'm just going to leave them alone. 15 entities, is that correct? Probably. Do it. Again, this is a relative move, so the point I pick doesn't matter at all. But I'm gonna type in on the command line, less than 90 degrees, and 25 feet up. There we go. Redraw the map. And we can now show our wall again. Go. Well, you might see that something looks weird. Looking here doesn't look too bad, but what's happening over here? Well, that's because the wall is on the same sheet as all of these entities, and you might remember that sheets determine the order of things, and keeping it on the same sheet will make things a little bit difficult to handle otherwise. So I'm gonna hide the wall. And I've already prepared this battlement sheet before we started. If not, could just make one and place it lower in the list than the wall sheet. That means that whatever is on this sheet will appear on top of things on the wall sheet in the drawing. And I'm going to just grab all of these entities again, minus these, and I'm gonna put it on. Go. You can also see I already have a shadow on the battlement sheet, and point of that shadow is more visible when I unhide my wall again. And since the wall is on a temporary sheet, I don't really want it to be there. I'm just going to take the entire wall and also a temporary layer. I meant not temporary sheet. And I'm going to move the entire wall to the wall's layer as well. There we go. That's basically it. And now you can see this shadow. Turn off effects for a little while. Effects off. You can see with effects off, it's really difficult to see that this battlement here, the parapet wall, is meant to extend beyond the wall. You can understand it if you look at this corner, it makes a little bit sense, but if you look at this part of the wall, it doesn't look like it extends from the wall at all. And that's what that shadow is all about. Once I put in this shadow, you can see that we have a much more convincing illusion that something is actually coming forward here and extending beyond the wall. Now we can just decorate the wall slightly. We can throw in a nice little door down here. And perhaps a few cozy little windows. Using snaps to make sure the windows get at the same height, otherwise it could look quite weird. And getting heights and stuff like that correct when you work in a perspective or isometric view can be a bit tricky. But there you go. We now have our battlements. You have learned how to create ruined sections. And perhaps most important at all, you didn't just learn how to create a ruined section like that, but you basically learned how to construct a perspective object from the bottom up. Instead of using a predefined object, we drew the wireframe, we designed the object all the way through, we applied shading, and we grouped it, and we made it into a proper perspectives object. And which we could then copy around and use in different places in our drawing. So, I hope this was helpful, and I hope you enjoyed the video. And as I said in the beginning of the video, if you have any questions regarding how to do things in perspective, how did I accomplish things, maybe I didn't explain something in the video, something you need explained to you, I highly recommend you drop by the ProFantasy forums, link is in the video description, and ask the questions there. Not because I don't acknowledge questions on YouTube, I do as well, but the forums are easier to have extended discussions than comments below a video. So, but I will also answer comments on the video if I see comments here, so I'll see you anyway. Okay, so again, hope you learned something today, and I hope this video was interesting, and obviously, I would appreciate a comment if you want me to make more videos like this, if you find that this is worth it. So, thank you, thanks for watching, have a nice day.